My name is Meredith Nizat, and I'm the host of More Than a Name, and you're listening to More Than a Song, episode 59.
And welcome to this episode of More Than a Song. My name is Michelle Nizat, and this is the podcast dedicated to helping you discover the truth of Scripture hidden in today's popular Christian music. My goal is to teach you to connect portions of God's Word with the songs you're singing along with on the radio, to help you meditate on truths that will transform your way of thinking and ultimately your life. I mentioned last week that one of my listeners, Emily from California, requested this week's song, Jesus Messiah by Chris Tomlin, when she found herself reading in 2 Corinthians and immediately thought of the verse she was reading in song. When she asked if I had used this song yet, I hadn't, and it turns out to be the perfect song for Easter weekend. And I hope you had a weekend of worship as we slow down to consider the sacrifice of Christ for our sins. I hope you consider that every day, but this weekend it was especially a wonderful time to consider the sacrifice of Christ. And I want to continue to do that through our song.
He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing.
He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness, comes straight from 2 Corinthians 5:21. I mean, word for word. If you can sing this verse of this song from memory, you have God's word hidden in your heart already. This is the power of music. You know, I was talking to Lauren Daigle a few months ago, and for those of you who think I'm name-dropping, I'm really not. Lauren's the only artist that I know personally, and she attended the Christian school that I work at right now. She attended that school through her ninth grade year. She comes back every few months or from time to time when she's in town to really pour back into our students, and I just love her. And the first time we met, I had to tell her that she was episode 32, you know, and then I also used one of her Christmas songs after our first meeting, so she's also episode 43. But anyway, we really hit it off and just started talking about our shared love of the Word and music, and she told me that she and another friend were talking one day, and the friend had read some research that said the last thing to go in an Alzheimer's patient is rhythm and rhyme. Isn't that fascinating? So if you hide God's word in your heart through rhythm and rhyme or music, it gets tucked deep into the recesses of your soul. So I think it's just one more reason why it's really neat that we can memorize God's word through music. So when I pulled out 2 Corinthians, because that's where Emily was reading, and that's, of course, the first lyric of this song, I decided to go ahead and read 2 Corinthians from the beginning, just to see if by reading in context, it would shed any light on this focus verse that we experience in our song. And although I really encourage you to do the same, I mean, any good reason to just jump into God's word and start reading, I do believe that we can just hang out right here in this section that this verse is found in and still have a pretty good idea of the overall point that Paul is trying to make. And the section title that we're in 2 Corinthians, in my translation, says, "We are God's ambassadors." And I think that statement pretty much sums up what action we should be taking upon understanding this section of Scripture. And in fact, verse 18 tells us that God has given us a task. He's given us something to do. And I'm a parent. I give my children tasks all the time. My kids are 7 and 11. And the greatest struggle we have right now is obedience. And it's really not so much, or every time so much, that they are rebelling. The majority of the time, they're just distracted. And the task at hand is obviously not critical enough in their mind that it holds their focus. And so from time to time, they do flat out disobey. Sometimes it's because they think they have a better plan in mind. That plan usually entails doing the task later. And sometimes they delay the task because they need assistance or they're really not clear on what we're asking them to do. Do you see where I'm going here? Don't we do the same thing to our Heavenly Father? Let me rephrase. I do the same thing to my Heavenly Father. And if you can relate to anything I'm about to say, then we can just go ahead and share in our guilt, and hopefully with a repentant heart, we can share in that too. You know, God has given me a task. The task can be found in verse 18, and the task is reconciling people to Him. So why don't I obey in completing this task every day? A daily responsibility in the household, the kingdom of God, and why don't I do it? Well, perhaps I'm distracted. I might even be distracted by things that I'm doing for God. So I'm thinking, I'm doing something really good. This is my own plan. Is the task itself not critical enough in my own mind that I think of it daily as I go out into the world? Is that the problem? Perhaps, again, I think I have a better plan than God. You know, there was an actual time when I thought that God had, quote unquote, called me to be a disciple of believers to the exclusion of being evangelist to non-believers. And that's interesting because God's word tells all of us to go and make disciples. And this task is to all of us. And so, again, so important for you to be in God's word so you know exactly what it says, so that when you begin to have a faulty way of thinking, His word can kind of bring you back around to the truth. And so He, you know, this part is a little uncomfortable, Lord. You know, I'll just go stick with this other area that I'm more comfortable with, and really tried to justify that in my mind. Sometimes I'm like my kids. I have every intention to obey. Later. You know, this sounds great until you realize that delayed obedience is disobedience. And then even as I give this task to you, you know, I'm really not giving it to you. God gave it to you, but we're talking about it here. I realize that some of us might not be clear on what it means to reconcile others to God, and maybe we need help. So let's keep reading in our section of scripture here to see if we can get some clarity. Now, verse 15 of 2 Corinthians says, He died for everyone so that those who receive His new life will no longer live for themselves. Instead, they will live for Christ, who died and was raised for them. So then you jump down to verse 18 and it says, All of this is a gift from God who brought us back to Himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to Him. For God was in Christ reconciling the world to Himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And He gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making His appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ. Now, the Greek word for reconciliation in these verses, and again, of course, that last verse is our first verse, our first lyric, right? He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become His righteousness. I was reading in the New Living Translation, so it read a little bit differently. But the Greek word here for reconciliation in these verses is katalasso, and it refers to the exchange of hostility for a friendly relationship. That's what reconciliation is. God brought us back to Himself through Christ. He exchanged a hostile relationship with us for a friendly relationship with us through Christ. Christ was the conduit of that exchange. So what does this reconciliation mean? Well, it means that God, through Christ, no longer counts our sins against us. That's what that scripture just said. So what is the appeal? The appeal is come back to God. There's a new relationship He wants to have with you. God is making His appeal to other people through us. We are His ambassadors, His representatives here on earth. Jesus with skin on. I think in a political sense, when we have ambassadors living in a foreign country, those ambassadors are the U.S. in that foreign country. They are representing the United States of America in that country. They are basically the United States with skin on. And so they are making appeals. We can make, the United States government makes appeals to those foreign countries through our ambassadors who are living in their land. And so that's exactly what's happening here. We are Christ's ambassadors, and we are making that appeal, God's appeal, He's making that appeal through us. We are Jesus with skin on. And so what message did he give us? What are our talking points, so to speak? Because those ambassadors living in the foreign countries are going to have talking points. And so what are our talking points? Well, they're all right here in the scripture we just read. You know, you could say it like this. Hey, friend, there's a way to have a father-child friendly relationship with God rather than a judge-criminal relationship with God. He sent his son, Jesus, to die for us. And even though Jesus never sinned, he acted as a substitute or an offering for our sin so that we can have this new relationship with God where God no longer counts our sins against us. So if you are hearing my voice and you have not been reconciled to God through Christ, would you please consider me God's ambassador to you? Consider what I just said as a personal appeal and an invitation to come back to God. All you have to do is believe and receive. So let's get back to the lyrics of our song and a small thing that might trip you up. This idea that Jesus became sin, what does that mean? You know, because the lyric says he became sin who knew no sin. Well, I found a fantastic article this week to really support what I'm going to say in a very simplistic manner. If you're interested, I'm going to link to it in the show notes. You can head over to michellenezat.com/59. But scripturally, we should not interpret this as God in the flesh, perfect and without sin, changing his nature into a sinful nature, as much as it should be interpreted as Christ took on our sin through substitution, not transformation. And I love this quote that I found in the article. It says, "The innocent was punished voluntarily as if guilty, that the guilty might be gratuitously rewarded as if innocent." And so, again, if you think about this, the innocent was punished voluntarily as if guilty. So Jesus was innocent. And he was punished as if he was guilty, but he really wasn't guilty. And we have been gratuitously rewarded as if innocent, but we are really not innocent. We really are sinners. He is not going to count our sins against us anymore because of Christ, because Christ was that offering for us. So again, if you're just interested in the article I found, it was very well written, documented, digs a little deeper than I did here, but I just wanted to make sure you didn't get tripped up with that idea of Jesus becoming sin. And for this reason, I really like that New Living Translation because it says, "For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin so that we could be made right with God through Christ." So let's move on to another part of this song. I don't want to leave out addressing kind of the last line of the first verse. So I'm going to grab that last line and also along with another verse as we jump back to the song.
He humbled himself and carried the cross. His body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love.
Truly love so amazing. I just love all of these references to scripture, all of this truth just packed into these lyrics of this song. There's a verse that talks about Jesus humbling himself and carrying the cross. There's verses talking about his body is the blood and the bread and the blood, his blood, the wine that he's broken and poured out. There are verses talking about the fact that the whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. And as I got through this, and then we're going to jump in a minute to all the names of Christ that are in this song. And there are so, it's just full of God's word. And so what I did for you this week is I did all the research for you and I created a resource that you can download for free and use to study kind of all of, or there are probably many verses, but I chose certain verses to kind of reflect the lyrics of our song this week. And so you can kind of listen to the song and study those verses. And so I've made that available to you at michellenezat.com/59download. So again, the show notes are at /59, but if you go to /59download, there's a free PDF that you can download and print out and then study those verses while you're listening to the song. I give you all of those verses there on that resource. So because Easter just happened and because I've been thinking about this all week, I put this song into my playlist and just play it all week. And so I've been playing it all week and looking up these verses and pondering all of this. It's just done wonders for me, and I wanted to make that available to you as well. So let's jump into the chorus. Jesus Messiah. Now, the natural response to the truths displayed in this song and the correlating scriptures that their lyrics come from, the natural response to that should be worship. And Jesus himself taught us to pray, and he used a model that acknowledged the holiness of God first. And when he said, "Hallowed be your name," some versions say, "Holy is your name." You know, we are to be in awe of God's name. And you heard Meredith introduce me today, and she has her own little podcast called More Than a Name. We just have a couple of episodes out so far, but the whole idea is that if we get to know his name, we get to know him. And so it's so true. Jesus himself regarded the name of God with feelings of respect and reverence. And so one of the best ways to worship him is to worship him through his many names. And so there are several in this chorus, starting out with Jesus Messiah. And I love what John does for us at the end of his gospel. He says, "Everything I wrote to you in this book is written so that you may continue to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing in him, you will have life by the power of his name." You know, our chorus says, "Name above all names." Philippians says, "God elevated Jesus to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all other names." Blessed Redeemer, Hebrews 9 says, "With his own blood, not the blood of goats and calves, he entered the most holy place once for all time and secured our redemption forever." Emmanuel. Oh, you can't even, from the beginning, of course, the angel said to Mary in Matthew chapter 1, the virgin will conceive a child, she will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. Colossians talks about him being the rescue for sinners, where it says he has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his dear son, who purchased our freedom and forgave our sins. And then 1 Peter talks about him being the ransom from heaven. It says, "You know that God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And it was not paid with mere gold or silver, which lose their value. It was the precious blood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God. God chose him as your ransom long before the world began. But now in these last days, he has been revealed for your sake." And of course, he is Lord of all. He himself said in John, "You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, because that is what I am." And Philippians reminds us that every tongue will declare that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. You know, Messiah literally means anointed one or chosen one. Jesus was chosen by God to reconcile us to himself. And so we end where we began today with our task: to be ambassadors for Jesus, to be ambassadors for our Messiah, to go and call others back to himself, just like he did through Christ with all of us who have already believed and received. So what's next? Well, I want you to spend some time just in that resource that I have for you. I really spent a lot of time creating this week's resource. I did all the work to find the verses, but if you'll take the time to really study them and to meditate on them, and I'm not talking about like reading through it really quickly, but maybe really spending time on each thought or each idea. And if for some reason that verse kind of inspires you to go read the rest of the chapter, by all means, that's kind of the point. Just get into God's word. But you can put that song, the song on repeat, and really begin to ponder the verses along with the song. I think it's going to be a really great resource for you. Again, it's found at michellenezat.com/59download. And while you're in God's Word this week, let me know how you're doing. Can you email me at michelle@michellenezat.com? You can hop on Twitter or Facebook. We can talk about what you're learning, or you can leave a comment on this week's show notes at michellenezat.com/59. Just a few quick announcements before we leave today.
My name is Meredith Nezat, and I have a podcast called More Than a Name. I believe that if we get to know His name, we get to know Him. You can check it out on iTunes and share it with your friends.
As a side note, on Meredith's podcast, More Than a Name, her very first episode was on the name Messiah, so you should check it out. And then I want to personally thank you for listening with a gift. I don't want you to have any excuses for not having God's Word front and center every day. So if you log onto my website at michellenezat.com, subscribe with your name and email address, I'm going to email you memory verse resources every week to display on your smartphone, your tablet, your desktop, or you can even print it out and place it in the best location for you. It's just a small token of my thanks and hopefully a useful tool for you. And I want to welcome my newest subscriber, Ange from Massachusetts. Welcome. Now, don't miss an episode of my podcast by subscribing to it in iTunes or Stitcher Radio. While you're in iTunes, could you please leave me a written review and a star rating? It really encourages me, but more than that, it helps me stay visible to new listeners. And as always, if you take the time to review my podcast, I will take the time to personally thank you right here on the podcast. That's it for this episode of More Than a Song. Next week, I will use Ellie Holcomb's song, Marvelous Light, to dive into Scripture. If you liked this episode, would you mind sharing it with others? I've made it really easy. With just one click, you can share via Facebook, Twitter, or email. Just head over to michellenezat.com/59. While you're there, I'd love to hear from you. Click on comment to join the conversation. Until next time, take time to meditate on God's Word and consider His ways.